Now, leave apart that issues, which is not relevant to the management. From the management point of view, when I manage the patients of alcohol induced conditions, there are some new feeling that there is some drugs to prevent the alcoholism. I don't give any such medicines. I don't advise any medicine to prevent the alcohol contents. The only thing is the patient has to have the willpower. Antabuse, which is very popularly used as alcohol preventing drug, the addiction, de-addicting drug, is very harmful. Of course, there are many people, de-addiction camps, and that de-addiction is a very popular job source now. I use the word job source with some of the scorn as such. The counseling is fine, but drugs used for the prevention of the alcoholism, they are very dangerous. It's a double-edged knife, so I don't suggest any of that. There are many people who advise this also, and many of the Ayurvedic practitioners also, they claim that they have some solution for this, Shrikhanda, Sava, and so on. But in my view, none of the drug can really prevent a person from taking alcohol other than that the antabuse. Antabuse is one drug which is very harmful, but as far as Ayurvedic drug is concerned, I don't prescribe any Ayurvedic medicine to prevent the alcohol. Only I would suggest the person to have a willpower. If the person has a willpower, definitely we can help. Withdrawal of alcoholism can produce certain complications, complications like loss of sleep, tremors, etc., anxiety. That can be managed with Smriti Sagarasa effectively. I do prescribe such persons who have withdrawn alcohol, but they have this anxiety or so on, to help. It's not to, very important, it's not to prevent alcoholism, it's only a symptomatic management of alcohol withdrawal symptoms. I prescribe Smriti Sagarasa, Saraswatarista, or occasionally Tailadhara. Tailadhara or Matrabasti, which can, it's all signs of Vata Prakopa, because all these are the signs of Vata Prakopa, and they can be effectively managed provided the patient has a willpower. The other medicines which I usually prescribe in patients who have alcohol-induced pathology are the same Arogyavardhini, Kamaduga, depending upon the presentations. So majority of the symptoms of alcohol withdrawal would be the tremors or so on, which is often the present symptom of Vata Prakopa. Occasionally, the patient may have a dyspepsia and nausea, so on, Pitta Prakopa Lakshanas. In such conditions, I may prescribe Kamaduga. This is the usual prescription, and provided the patient has a willpower, definitely a alcohol withdrawal can be done safely. Alcohol withdrawal is not a risky issue. Unlike the other drugs, addiction-forming drugs like these opium derivatives, alcohol withdrawal doesn't produce any critical risks as such, and hence they can be managed only if the patient has the willpower. Very rarely it may result in a hypoglycemia. Of course, it's not the alcohol withdrawal which could be a cause of hypoglycemia. What happens is the persons may go on an alcoholic binge, like they may withdraw alcohol for 1 or 2 days or 1 week, then all of a sudden they may take all that 7 days quota, and they may have that hypoglycemia. Patients with the severe hypoglycemia due to acute alcoholism, they are quite frequently visiting hospitals, and in such conditions we have no remedy. It has to be only the glucose. You have to give the immediately IV glucose has to be given. There is no other remedy. I don't suggest any Ayurvedic remedy for that, and that's the one of the life-saving measure. At that point it can be life-saving, and such incidences are increasing day by day. Now these days, as I have seen in my practice, such incidences were lesser earlier, but these days the incidence is increasing, and very often in the first week of January or New Year Day celebrations, or many times the third week of January, this week also, that's after the Ayyappa Yatra. So during Ayyappa Yatra, there will be a withdrawal. They have a forced withdrawal. But return journey, there will be all that excess, and that acute alcoholism induced hypoglycemia complications are more frequent in these seasons. Like there are certain of these, some festival seasons, Deepavali also, the incidences tend to occur. So when a patient is brought to the hospital with the altered consciousness, one of the important thing I do is get the blood sugar level. And if the blood sugar level is low, we start with the immediate glucose, and many times the patient would recover. So you have a confusion like whether the patient has a stroke or some other cerebrovascular pathology and so on. So that's one of the basic clue, and this is important in the festival seasons often. And of course, even otherwise season also, often when there is a marriage in household, like so on. So these are the issues, incidences where you will have that acute alcoholism binges. Next part. Next. Now, non-alcoholic fatty liver pathology. This is another of the critical problem which we face. Incidence is increasing quite rapidly. Though I often say that it is due to the excess of the drugs taken by the patients. Patients who are living on drugs, for each and everything, there is a medicine and the patients take pages together of prescriptions. Such of the patients, they tend to develop these complications. With all the contemporary drugs, though a drug alone might not be hepatotoxic, but when the drug is given in combinations, multiple drugs are given, it can result in many unexplained conditions, and the hepatic damage could be one of the conditions. And many a times you will not have any clinical symptoms. The clinical symptoms can be wide varying many a times. It could be lots of variant conditions. Many times the patient would be apparently healthy, or the patient may have simple, general, vague symptoms like weight loss or sudden weight gain. Both can occur in a hepatic fatty degeneration. And as you palpate, you may not find anything abnormal. But only when you do a USG, you may see that. Even the biochemical tests may be normal in a large number of patients. And that they become quite difficult conditions. Causes for this also are many. And among the other critical causes, obesity is one of the critical causes. Patients who are obese, the incidence is quite high and it's one of the very critical causes. Patients who have intestinal disorders, chronic colitis like conditions, the possibility of fatty degeneration is very high. So when we treat such patients, we have to be extra careful. And pregnancy. Multiple pregnancies also can be a cause for the fatty liver. These are the very critical conditions. And the drugs which produce these are well known, established, are plenty of those drugs which I have already mentioned, the list as such. Among them, one of the critical drugs is valproic acid, which is used in the treatment of seizure disorders. Seizure disorders, valproic acid, producing fatty degeneration, the incidence is quite significant. And because the drug has to be given for long duration, that's the point which I said, like the review of the dosages. With this, there is a need to review the doses. When a patient is on valproic acid, it's not that you advise the dose once and then continue. You have to monitor the liver functions regularly. And if necessary, the dosage has to be reviewed. And when a patient comes to me with that, see, a patient on valproic acid for years together, withdrawal of the drug is not an easy thing. It cannot be withdrawn, because withdrawal itself can precipitate the seizures quite significantly. So all that I do is I review the dosages and then I supplement such patients with the Smriti Sagar, Arogyavardhini and Saraswati Arista. Many of the patients can be effectively managed and the complications can be avoided. That's one of the critical area which we face in the clinical practice. Rest of the drugs, of course, all the drugs are important. I'm not saying the other drugs are not important, but this is one of the crucial area where often the patients come for Ayurvedic management, and that's how I manage. Next part. Now, the cirrhosis, the next of the complications related to the liver. Cirrhosis, as I told you, is a irreversible pathology where there is a necrosis and fibrosis and regeneration. And the proof of the cirrhosis, according to the guideline, should be biopsy. But I say biopsy is not mandatory. With the ultrasonography itself, we can make out the cirrhosis as a diagnosis. The most important is when the albumin level is reduced in a patient where the albumin level is less than normal, even if there are no other obvious evidences of the cirrhosis, we can take it for granted that the patient has cirrhosis. I don't consider biopsy as a critical level for the diagnosis, though universal standard says that a final diagnosis of cirrhosis should be done only with the biopsy. Liver biopsy is not a safe option. Liver biopsy has many risks, and particularly in a patient who has a cirrhosis, the risks are very higher. So I don't recommend the biopsy to all the patients. If the patient has already a biopsy, fine. But I don't recommend the patients for the biopsy, which is usually away from the usual guideline. Next part. The radiological evidences of ultrasonography, that nodular changes, is enough to make the diagnosis. And the most crucial part is whether there is an evidence of the portal hypertension or not. The flow, blood flow in the portal circulation is the crucial issue. So next part, next slide. The causes could be many. The important is the causes of cirrhosis are many. It's very difficult to identify the cause many a times. Very critical would be patients who had a viral hepatitis, particularly B and C. In the long run, it can result in the cirrhosis. That's one of the important issue. Then, as I told you, drug-induced pathologies are the other conditions. Important other way are autoimmune disorders. Many of the patients with the autoimmune pathology like sclerosing cholangitis or even rheumatism also can be in long run a source for cirrhosis. Rarely, though it's not a frequently quoted example or frequently quoted incidence, I have seen many patients with the rheumatism developing cirrhosis, whether it is due to rheumatism or the treatment for the rheumatism. HCQS, hydroxyquinoline, which is described as the choice of drug in case of the rheumatism, can also be a source for cirrhosis now. So whether it is due to that or not is the other issue. So the causes of the cirrhosis are many, and most of the times, a exact cause cannot be identified. Whether we need to give stress to the identification of a cause or not is the next question. Many times, you may have lots of efforts to identify the cause, but at the time, virtually, there is no effective management. So, when I say this, I don't mean to say that you should not think about the causes. But it depends upon the financial status of the patient. If a patient is of a poor status, I won't stress upon the identification of the causes, because ultimately, the real outcome would be the same, and the treatment would also be the same. So many times I have treated many patients with cirrhosis without really knowing the exact cause for the cirrhosis. So though cirrhosis is not a final diagnosis, I have treated many patients, though it's against the ethics now. I'm not saying that this is the ethics. Ethics is you have to follow the guideline, but without that following also we can manage and have some satisfactory outcome in the patients. Like next slide. Most common now, all that important is, most common cause for the cirrhosis is considered to be alcoholism. And there are certain practitioners who ask that first question, like whether you have taken alcohol or not. But remember that alcoholism is not the only cause. Non-alcoholic cirrhosis also is quite common. And you need not look at the patient with the suspicion, like this patient is hiding about its alcoholic habit. But the important is the grading. Now, when I treat the patient, now, selection of the patient is the most important issue. Certain of the patients are critical, and I don't consider them as a status where we can manage with our medicines. To decide that, I use that the popular, the PUG scoring techniques. The PUG scoring technique is simple, very simple issue. Assessing these issues, clinical signs, like when there is a no encephalopathy, you give 1 point. When there is a significant encephalopathy, you may have a 3 points, which increases the grade as such. Ascites, when there is ascites, again the grade is increased. A patient with cirrhosis developing a hyperbilirubinemia, the total bilirubin level is more than 3 or 4, then you consider this as a high-risk patient. And the bilirubin in bile as such also is the one, urinary bile also is important issue. But another critical issue is the albumin level. Albumin level being lower is the most critical issue, which suggests about the severity. Grade 3 conditions, the outcome is very poor. With our management, most of the times it ends in fatal complications. Whereas grade 1 conditions, they can be managed easily. So I always prefer to treat the patients in grade 1. Grade 3 patients, I don't say that I would refuse the treatment, but the outcome can be predicted to the patient, like the outcome would be poor, and virtually there is no other curative management except the possibility of hepatic transplantation. Next slide. The course of the disease and development of the complications. Hepatitis, the cirrhosis can even result in a hepatocellular carcinoma, or even it can result in a fatal complication. The incidence of that, the time taken for that disease and the incidence of the disease also is increasing these days. Whereas hepatocellular carcinoma incidence is somewhat now lesser, whereas cirrhosis resulting in a fatal complication otherwise in India is increasing rapidly these days. Again, the causes, will not go into that issue of the causes, but cirrhosis is a burning problem. Next part. Now, cirrhosis, though it's not described in our text directly, the complication of the ascites formation is described in the context of the jalodhara, and the description of the Jalodhara is the exact manifestation of the portal hypertension, where Kosta Upasneha Dhanasaraha Nisritya Doshaha Anilaveganunaha. It results in the accumulation of the fluid in the abdomen, and that results in the complications as such. Or it also can present with the clinical features of the Pittodhara, where the patient may have a jaundice. So cirrhosis may present either with jaundice or with only the ascites formation. These are described either as Jalodhara or the Pittajodhara. Pittajodhara or Jalodhara, both of them are considered as asadhya conditions in Sushruta. Next part. Hence the outcome would be always pure. The management, the most important issue in the management when I treat is, the first is if there is a esophageal varices. Patients who have esophageal varices with the cirrhosis, they are high risk conditions. Nobody can predict when the patient would develop a bleeding. And a bleeding from the esophageal varices is very acute and life threatening. It has to be an emergency condition. So when a patient presents with the varices, I would suggest the patient to go for a interventional treatment, either clipping or sclerosing therapy. And generally when the patient has that kind of a treatment, we'll manage. I don't do the clipping because though I do have endoscope, I don't do the clipping in case of esophageal varices because it's a high risk procedure. A clip placed slightly out of the area can result in a bleeding there itself on the table. So it's a high risk potential condition. So if a patient is cirrhosis with the varices comes in, I do go for the esophagoscope. If there is a varices, I would not negotiate my esophagoscope beyond that area. Once there is a varices, I withdraw my esophagoscope, refer the patient to some other hospital. And when the patient has a clipping, only after that I may treat the patients. Now, once the patient had this clipping, to prevent the recurrence of bleeding, of course, prevent the recurrence of the varices, my choice of treatment is Aarogyavardhini, Kamaduga and Ushirasava. It's a variant of Raktapitta. I manage on the lines of Raktapitta variation. And it's not a treatment for esophageal varices. It should be there. I consider this as a prevention of the recurrence of the varices. If a patient has a varices, I would always recommend the patient for a primary treatment elsewhere, and then to prevent the recurrence, which can be done. And with this, effectively, we can prevent as such. Of course, esophageal varices tend to recur quite frequently even after the interventional treatment. Then, when a patient has a fluid accumulation in the abdomen, that's once the patient has ascites, of course, the primary treatment will be Aarogyavardhini and Kumariyasava. But along with that, and the lines of Jalodhara Chikitsa, I would add Punarna Mandura or Punarna Vasava. One of the very significant advantage or a significant beneficiary line of treatment which I use is Gomutra with the Tripala Churna. Gomutra collected daily, it's a fresh Gomutra, with the Tripala Churna I prescribe. Gomutra Arka, which is available in the market, will not have the same results. I have observed both. Many times that Gomutra Arka would produce more irritation, whereas a fresh Gomutra collected would be definitely beneficial. So we have that Gomutra provision in our hospital. I have established that part. But the problem comes in when the patient goes home, and in urban condition, the patient may not be able to have that Gomutra. So it depends upon whether the patient is able to do that or not. With the Gomutra and the Trifala, one of the important issues is, first 1 week, I keep the patient in the hospital. I don't advise the patients to take Gomutra at home as such, because I have observed a good number of patients, when we start with the Gomutra, there is a possibility of a widespread peritonitis within 1 week. If the patient has tolerated that Gomutra for 1 week, chances of peritonitis developing is lesser. Maybe it could be one of the possibility of tests, like whether the outcome would be poorer or not. Patient developing peritonitis, the outcome would be very poor, and the complications will be very serious. So I do keep it as a rule, like when I start with the Gomutra in a patient of cirrhosis, for the first 1 week, I keep the patient in the hospital, observe daily, and only when I'm sure that the patient has not developed peritonitis, I discharge the patient and advise the patient to take Gomutra at home. Rarely I advise the patient to take Gomutra at home as such. This is other crucial issue. Gomutra may not be a universally safe prescription. But once the patient has got accustomed to that, the results will be dramatically good. I have many patients where the results are dramatically good, in the sense a huge ascites completely having a resolution, patients looking normal, the and the patients had to change their pant and shirt also. Such of the incidences are not rare. We have plenty of cases, but the major problem is predictability. To predict exactly like in which patients the outcome would be good would be very difficult, but I have already discussed some of those issues which I consider as the possibility of prediction of the prognosis.